As you have come here, ask them to stop it. What are they doing?
Ask them to stop the buses, please.
I mean, for half an hour they are going
on. Stop the buses.
They should not make any noises.
Hamid, tell them to switch the engine off.
This place Nasik has a special significance that long time back, say about 8,000 years back, when Sri Rama went away for his exile, he came to Maharashtra and he passed through various places and he settled down in Nasik, this place, with his wife. And here a lady who was actually the wife was the sister of Ravana, called Shurpanakha. She tried to entice Sri Rama. Now, this quality of enticing men or enticing women are really demonic. And that is how people call them Rakshasas. Because those who are demonic people are people who are by nature aggressive, full of ego, want to overpower everyone. And they feel quite satisfied if their ego is satisfied. So all the people who were like that were called as Rakshasas in this country. Was not a normal human behavior, according to them. So these Rakshasas were more living in the northernmost part of India, and they have different categories as described. So those who run after women were called by some other name, and where the women try to dominate, they are called by some other name. Where the men try to become like women, there's another name. But they were never called as human beings. They were called as Rakshasas or Vetalas and all other names. But nowadays you find such a confusion that you don't know whom to call what. But the human beings in those days were sensible, matured people. who with the age matured. Now you have to notice, on the streets of Maharashtra, just now I was coming by train, I saw no men's, there were nobody who was interested in women, no women were interested in men. Some men were hugging each other, walking around more innocently. I mean, the whole thing was that life is innocence. And that is what it was here when this Rakshasa's sister, Shurpanakha. So nowadays if there's any woman in India who behaves like this, tries to entice men, is called as Shurpanakha. So this woman came and tried to entice Sri Rama. Imagine, what audacity. So Sri Rama, being Sankochi, means he was a man full of grace, he told her, see now, what's the use of running after me? I have already got a beautiful wife. So why do you run after me? Better try my brother who has no wife, because he knew his... because he knew that his brother is a Sheshnaga, he is the serpent on which, very big serpent called Sheshnaga, Shesha. And he is a hot-tempered fellow, and he will just know how to deal with this woman. I can't manage this show, because he would not ill-treat a woman. It was too much for him. Though she was Shurpanakha, and not only that, but she was also a woman. So when he went, he asked her that you go and see him. Lakshmana was sitting outside. Lakshmana had taken a vow to be a brahmachari, celibate man, with 14 years penance. Though he was a married man, this he had to do, but that's the only way he could kill another demon whose name was Meghnath, who had run away with his daughter called as Sulochana. It's a long story. So make it short, this fellow went to this brahmachari, Lakshmana, though he had a wife in Ayodhya, he was leading a life of a brahmachari. It's very common in India. I mean, if your wife is away, you just think about her, and you are in separation, still you enjoy your wife thinking about her and thinking about the good things she has done to you. But if she has done all the time bad things, you don't want to think about her. And then all these demonic things start. All right. So this, when she went and started, she dressed up very well in a very attractive manner, tried to show off her body and all that in the very funny way, and not in a traditional decent way, but a very indecent, indecorous manner, just to attract the fellow. He was so angry with her, he just cut her nose, so she should not do this said to anybody else, and get rid of her pride of nonsense, to kill her ego. Because nose is the one that expresses actually the ego part. So when he cut his nose, the nose is called as Nasika in Sanskrit language. It's called as Nasika. This is the place where the nose was cut. And that's why this place was called as Nasik. So now, we have to remember, we have come to an area where noses can be cut. So one has to be careful. And on the watch out that we do not show any symptom like Shurpanakha did. Henceforth, we should behave in a manner that we are sahajogis and sahajoginis. And we have to have that right type of conduct which comes from the purity inside. So, as this is now actually the beginning of the tour in the real sense of the word, I have to make certain suggestions to all of you that our behavior should be very decent and decorous, so that all the vibrations that are flowing through us, which are holy vibrations, auspicious vibrations, should not be spoiled by our ego or our Shurpanakha ideas or any such nonsense which has no relevance to your ascent. All this comes from decadence. The decadence we have gone through. And because you have come up, you can see the decadence of the society. So here you have to show, through your good behavior, good dress and good conduct, the beauty that you have developed within yourself, and that now you belong to a society which has ascended. And the decadence is over now. It's only for you to watch that and to help others to come out of it. Beginning of the tour at Nasik is a very holy and auspicious thing that has happened to all of you, because the river here, Godavari, is called as the Ganges of the South. But as in every pure thing, all the filth is put in, this great, we call it kshetra, the pilgrimage, is ruined by many people who want to exploit. We call them as bhajjis. They are the ones who are making money out of the temples, out of the holiness of this place. To them, Sahaja Yoga is a challenge, because you can do it without any money, without any work, without any extra sacrifices. That they can't understand. According to the theory of all these people, all over the world, if you see, is this, that all those who are seeking should hand over the purse to the people who are in charge, first of all. Secondly, those who are seeking should become absolutely miserable in their seeking. They should suffer, suffer and suffer, till they become just bones and die. They have to go on sacrificing everything, going through tortures till they reach God. This is not the way the ascent has to be achieved, as you have learnt it. So this is true not only of Hindus, also of Jains, also of Christianity, also of Islam. The way it is preached today is all adharma. There is no dharma in it. That's why the establishment of our dharma is very important, which is the pure religion which gives you ascent, joy, peace and the blessings of God. This is what is Vishwa Nirmala Dharma. Now I have to also say that this place has another significance, that we have a very powerful Jain, a gentleman, who is come to this dharma. Now, Jainism, again the same style it's going, same perversions as we have seen. Like in Jains, if I go on telling you, you will laugh and laugh and your stomach will start paining. So I don't want to go about it the way the Jains are mad about vegetarianism. They want to save all the mosquitoes, bugs, everything, and kill the human beings. All right, it's money. They are the Jews of our country, and they have really extracted people, all their money, everything, very rich people here. But they don't kill a mosquito or kill a bug. That's what they are. So now, this kind of thing is on. And Dr. Sanghvi, who is a very learned man, his wife is another very affectionate and dedicated Sahajogini, his son, daughter-in-law, all of them have understood that religion cannot be such madness that you start saving the mosquitoes and not the human beings. The attention is from the other end, which of course against Mahavira's principle. Mahavira, on the contrary, has described the hell the best. He is the one who, being the incarnation of the essence of Bhairava, has described the hell very well, and in England we have William Blake, who has also done the same way because he's the same style, he's the same thing. What is hell that he described? There are worms, there are mosquitoes, this, that. And just the opposite of that is to save the mosquitoes and bugs. Shows how we go just the other way round, how we oppose the religious achievements of these great people, those who try to preach something sensible, how we make it a nonsense out of it. That is how here we see that the Jains should see how Sri Mahavira is being misinterpreted and insulted in many places. This is a very big achievement, I feel, that some people have started seeing this light, and they will start seeing it more and more. Also, we have some very good here musicians, as you have heard him, and his whole party was so beautiful. I heard about him that he sang beautiful songs for you, and you enjoyed all the music program. And he also sang some very nice English songs. It's a good beginning. Because as you are singing Marathi songs and Hindi songs, our Indians also should sing, but they make a melody out of everything. So you have to little bit guide them, because they are, you see, they are melody-oriented musicians. So we try to make melody out of everything, otherwise it doesn't, you see, go with our minds all right. So you have to give some guidance, and you have to forgive them if you think it's not absolutely all right. So we have to thank all the people over here for being so kind and so nice to us in receiving. And I hope you are all very comfortable in that place. The only problem was we couldn't get a proper place, as Dr. Sanghvi was worried, because you see Indians are too much hospitable. And he said, I'll have to cover all the sides, I don't want them to get the cold, this, that, I'll put some heaters there. But by God's grace, there is no need. It's so pleasant. I was just smiling at him, I said, don't you worry, everything will work out. And it has worked out, you know, we don't need any heaters. If we need anything, we might need some fans. Like in Madras, they said, we have no water, we have to buy water now from other places. Going to be, we are all going to be dying. I said, all right, we'll have water. So it rained so much that they had floods. So it should not be felt that there is a problem with the nature. Nature is always with you, will always help you, will be kind. But we have to be kind to ourselves, to our nature. And the nature that we have is that we are human beings. We are not rakshasas, we are not devils. We can't do all these things which are devilish. which are nonsensical. And once we understand that we are saints, we will know that we have to keep our sainthood in such a manner that others can see through our behavior. Nasik has another great heritage that many saints came and did tapas, this tapobhumi. Nasik area is the tapobhumi, is the land of tapas, tapasyas. And that's why this is a very, very auspicious land. And here it is. You will see on your way to Dhulia, the incarnation of the Adi Shakti, which is the three powers of the Kundalini, completely integrated, expressed here as Sapta Shringi, meaning seven Shikharala Kaya Nishana.
Peaks.
Seven peaks. Now, seven peaks are the seven centers in the brain. And the Kundalini, though she has seven centers to pass through, the governing pithas, the seats, are in the peak, in the head. And so, Adi Shakti takes place in the Sahasrara. She incarnates in the Sahasrara. So we can say that this is the Sahasrara of Maharashtra or of the universe in a way, though Himalaya is regarded as the real abode of Sadashiva, which is on top. But the Sahasrara part, which is the limbic area, should be here, because we have three and a half coils settled here. That's why the Kundalini of the universe is here. But as the Saptashringi has come out of Mother Earth, this is the place where we can say resides the Sahasrara. Though the on top is the Himalaya, and Himalaya, we can say, is beyond Sahasrara. The three powers of the goddess, I don't know if you will be seeing all these three expressed in three different places in the Maharashtra, but this is the Ardhamatra, the half one, which is the Adi Shakti herself. And this is what you see in this place. And I'm sure you'll enjoy it tomorrow when you go on your way to Dhulia. With this understanding that in a subtle way we are in a very important place, I hope you all will rise above mundane, gross attention into a subtler attention, into a higher attention, and enjoy the bliss of God. May God bless you. आता मी इंग्लिशमध्ये जरी बोलले असले तरी आपल्याला सगळं कळलं असेल, पण तरी सांगायचं म्हणजे असं की आपला सहजोग आहे, आणि सहज असल्यामुळे आपल्याला असं वाटतं की असेल माझा हरित देईल खाटल्यावर. तर सहज हा योग जो घडतो तो फक्त कुंडलिनीची जागृती आणि तुमचं सहस्रार भेदन इथपर्यंत आमचं तुमचं देणं घेणं आहे. आता पृथ्वी आहे, पृथ्वी मध्ये तुम्ही जर एखादं बी घातलं तर तिचं देणं घेणं एवढंच आहे की बा तुझ्यामध्ये मी अंकुर फोडते, पण त्यानंतर बघायला नको. तेव्हा जरी हे अगदी सहज असलं तरी आता मी संत झालो हे समजणं फार कठीण. आता आम्ही बी घडलो हे समजणं फारच कठीण गोष्ट आहे. अजून आम्ही तेच आहोत असं सारखं आपल्याला वाटत असतं, किंवा तसं नाही वाटलं तरी आपली वागणूक तशीच असते. तर ती बदलायला पाहिजे आणि समजलं पाहिजे की आता आपण संत झालो. आणि संतांची किती लक्षणं सांगितलेली आहेत रामदास स्वामींनी, प्रत्येकाने सांगितलेली आहे. त्या संतातली आपल्यामध्ये कोणची लक्षणं आहेत ती पाहिली पाहिजे, तिकडे लक्ष दिलं पाहिजे. ती लक्षणं आपल्यामध्ये दृष्टिगोचर का होत नाहीत, लोक आपल्यामध्ये ते शोधत का नाही, ते आपल्या त्यांना दिसत का नाही, त्याला कारण काय हे पाहिलं पाहिजे. तर सर्वप्रथम आपण असा विचार केला पाहिजे की परमेश्वरांनी आपल्याला अंकुरलं आहे, बरं झालं, आता पुढे काय, आम्ही काय केलं त्या परमेश्वरासाठी. आम्हाला सहयोगामध्ये हे माहिती आहे की प्रत्येकाला आशीर्वादित करतो परमेश्वर. योग क्षेम वाम्यम, योग मिळाला तुम्हाला क्षेम घ्याच, ते त्याच्यात बंडलच त्याच्याच बरोबरच येते, समजा बिल्टीन, त्याला काही करायला नको, क्षेम घ्या. पण क्षेमाबरोबर एक आणखीन यायला पाहिजे, कृतज्ञता, ती येत नाही. कृतज्ञता जर आली तर लगेच हा विचारील की माझ्याला मला एवढं फुकटात मिळालं, आम्ही काय केलं होतं, कशाला असं मिळालं, कसं मिळालं, आता मी काय देऊ जीव का प्राण, असा विचारायला पाहिजे. पण येणे माझ्या मागल्या, माताजी असं झालं, नोकरी तर लागली, पैसे मिळू लागले, पण अजून माझ्या मुलीचं लग्न झालेलं नाही, भरतही झालं, मग अमकं राहिलं, म्हणजे तेच चालूच आहे तुमचं, जे मागचं होतं तेच पुढे सुरू आहे, त्याला काही अर्थ आहे का? तर सहजात तुम्ही आले ह्याचा अर्थ असा आहे की तुम्ही पहिल्यांदा संत झाले. आता दुसरा जो शब्द योग आहे त्याच्याकडे लक्ष जर दिलं, योगाला अर्थ दोन आहेत. योग म्हणजे परमेश्वराशी आपला संबंध होणे, किंवा शिवाजीवाचा संबंध होणे, त्यांची सांगड बसणे, ते झालं. पण सांगड नाही बसलेली, नुसतं तुमचं संबंध झालेले फक्त, असं समजायचं पहिल्यांदा. पण योगाला दुसरा अर्थ असा आहे की युक्ती, कौशलम, कुशलता पाहिजे. सहजयोगाची तुम्ही युक्ती शिकले का, त्याची कुशलता शिकले का? नाही, मग त्याला काय अर्थ आहे? अर्धवटच झालं ते. म्हणजे आपली समजा बाहेर आम्ही पाटी लावली एक, इथे सांगवी राहतात, तर तुम्ही ते पाटी वाचून गेलाय, तुम्ही भेटले का सांगव्यांना? तसलाच हा प्रकार आहे. त्याची जर तुम्हाला कुशलता नाही आली, एखाद्या युनिव्हर्सिटीला तुम्ही गेले, भाऊ आम्ही गेलो तो युनिव्हर्सिटी पाहून आलो, प्रोफेसरांना भेटलो, बरं, मग तुम्ही पुढे काय? मग आम्ही झालो की आम्ही ग्रॅज्युएट आहोत, कसं नाही, म्हणजे आम्ही जाऊन आलो तर म्हणून. आपल्याकडे इंग्लंडला कुणी जाऊन यायचा काही केलं नाही, तिकडे तसंच आला परत, आपण म्हणतो ना झक मारून, तरीसुद्धा त्याला इंग्लंड रिटर्न आपण म्हणत असो. तसलाच प्रकार आहे. सहयोगी आम्ही, सहयोगी सहयोगी सहयोगी, बरं का? मग ह्या बोटाला काय अर्थ आहे, इकडे जळलं म्हणजे काय होतं ते माहीत नाही बा. आम्ही सहयोगी होत, बिल्ले लावून आम्ही सहयोगी झालो, तसं सहयोगात होत नाही. काहीतरी व्हावं लागतं आणि त्यासाठी काहीतरी करावं लागतं, आणि त्या करण्यामध्ये एक गोष्ट लक्षात ठेवली पाहिजे की काही काही गोष्टींचा त्याग करावा लागतो. त्यातला एक त्याग आपण नेहमीच करतो म्हणजे बुद्धीचा त्याग, तो नको, ते सोडून पुढचं बोलायचं. बुद्धीचा त्याग करून मोकळं व्हायचं आणि म्हणायचं सहयोगानं आमची वाट लावली, तर ते एक सोडून बाकी जर त्यागाकडे दृष्टी असली, आम्ही काय सोडलं, जे बेकार होतं ते सोडलं, त्याला काही अर्थ नव्हता ते सोडलं, असा विचार करायचा. जसे ते हरिरामाचे लोक आले, मला म्हणायला आले तुम्ही एवढे श्रीमंतीत बसलेले, आता ते माझ्या नवऱ्याचंच आहे सगळं, मी तरी काय करू, तुम्ही एवढे श्रीमंतीत बसलेले आणि तुम्ही काय त्याग केला, तुम्ही कशा झाल्या म्हणे देवी. आवडलं, देवी त्याग नसते करत, तिचे त्याग करत नाही, बाकी सगळ्यांना करावला, तीच भोगती आहे. बरं कबूल म्हटलं, तुम्ही काय त्याग केले ते सांगा. पण आम्ही हे सोडलं ते सोडलं ते सोडलं हे सोडलं, म्हटलं असं का? बरं असं करा तुम्ही, माझ्या घरात किंवा माझ्या अंगावर तुम्हाला कोणतंही जर त्या श्रीकृष्णाच्या पायाच्या धुळीबरोबर किंवा त्याच्या कणाबरोबर एखादं काही मिळालं तर घेऊन जा म्हटलं तू. ते सांगा पण ते त्याच्या पायाच्या धुळीच्या कणाबरोबर असायला पाहिजे. तगडबडले गृहस्थ तसेच त्यांच्या तोंडावर इतक्या सुरकुत्या होत्या की मोजून घ्याव्यात आणि म्हणे आम्ही मोठे कृष्ण भक्त. म्हणजे काय कृष्णाला शोभेल का? कृष्ण भक्त म्हणजे कसे अगदी टवटवीत असायला पाहिजे, बसलेत ना सगळे. तर मी म्हटलं का ओ कृष्ण भक्त तुम्ही सांगत का नाही, तगडबडली तर काय दिसेस ना. म्हटलं काय तुम्ही मग दगड धोंड्यांचा त्याग केला काय? हे दगड धोंडेस ना, नाही तर काय ती राख तिचा त्याग केला. त्याग कशाचा करायचा? जर काही धरलंच नाही तर त्याग कशाचा करायचा? म्हणजे करायचं काय माणसानी की काही धरायचं नाही. त्याग करायचा म्हणजे काय? धरायचं नाही. हा माझा मुलगा, ही माझी मुलगी, ही माझी नोकरी, हे माझं घर, हे माझं ते, हे माझं ते, हे माझं आणि मी पण सुटलं पाहिजे. आणि हे जोपर्यंत सुटणार नाही सहजयोग जमणार नाही. ते सुटता आलं पाहिजे आणि ते सोडणं आपल्या महाराष्ट्रात जरा कठीण जातं. आणि मुलगा मुलगी म्हणजे जीव का प्राणी, एक डोळा हा दुसरा डोळा तो. त्यांनी म्हातारपणी लाथा मारल्यावर मग लक्षात येतं अरे बाबा हे काय केलं आपण. सगळं जग तुमचं कुटुंब व्हायला पाहिजे हे संतांचं लक्षण आहे. माझं पण गेलं पाहिजे, मी पण गेलं पाहिजे आणि ते जाण्यासाठी आयुष्य आम्ही सहयोगाला वाढून दिलंय, वाहून दिलंय. आता परमेश्वराशिवाय आम्हाला काय करायचं आहे? आम्ही परमेश्वराच्या कार्यात रत आहोत, आम्हाला टाईम नाही आता दुसऱ्या गोष्टीने. आमचं हृदय आम्ही परमेश्वराला वाहिलंय, आम्हाला आता कोणत्याही दुष्ट भावनांना हृदय नाही राहिलेलं. आमच्या बुद्धीत दुसरं काही सुचत नाही, फक्त सहयोग आणि त्या परमेश्वराच्या कार्यासाठी काय करायचं तेच आमच्या डोक्यात विचार चाललेले आहे. आमच्या जठरागिनीला सुद्धा दुसरं काही पचत नाही. तुम्ही काही बोलू नका दुसरं बाबा, आम्हाला चालायचंच नाही. परमेश्वराच्या साम्राज्यात बसल्यावर आम्ही दुसरं काय बोलायला तयार नाही, आमच्याजवळ वेळ नाही त्या गोष्टी. असं जेव्हा होईल तेव्हाच ते सुटणार. इतर गोष्टी सुटल्याशिवाय सहयोग जमू शकत नाही आणि त्या बाबतीत जरा कच्चे होत आपण. त्यामुळे सहयोगी तयार म्हणायला फार कमी, त्याच्यामुळे एका माणसावर सगळं पडतं आणि बाकीची मंडळी नुसती ढम्म बसून राहतात. नसली तरी थोडं बहुत करते. हळूहळू हळूहळू ते वाढत जातं पण त्याला काय की वाढीला इतकी इंचा इंचानी प्रगती होत आहे की त्यांनी सहजोग कसा फोपावेल हे समजत आहे. कारण इथे काहीतरी व्हावं लागतं. काही प्लास्टिकचं बनवता येत नाही की चला एका मशीनीत घातले माताजींनी सगळ्यांना आता तयार करून ठेवले इकडे पुतळे. ते मेलेलं काम आहे, जिवंत कार्य करायचं म्हणजे त्याला वेळ लागतो हे मलाही माहिती आहे. पण जरा जास्तच वेळ लागला म्हणजे जरा असं मग वाटतं की काय करावं, आता कसं करायचं. नाशकाला जरा जास्तच वेळ लागत आहे आणि इथे भागीरथी धावते आहे. रामानी आणि सीतेनी दोघांनी अनवाणी चालून इकडे पवित्र केलेलं आहे. ही तपोभूमी आहे, सगळे ह्यांना मी सांगते वर्णन करून. त्यात आदिशक्तीवरती गडावरती बसलेले आहेत सगळं असून इथे सगळ्यात गाडं जे आहे हळू चालत आहे. म्हणजे ज्या रथाला 100 घोडे लावले त्याच्यापेक्षा ते 2 घोडे लावलेलं खच्चर चांगलं चालतं आहे हे बघून आश्चर्य वाटतं नाही का? की ते जे गाडं आहे ते बरं चाललेलं आहे 2 घोड्याचं आणि हे 100 घोडेवाल्याचं काय झालं काही समजत नाही. आणि केवढी मेहनत घातली तुमच्या पूर्वजांनी इथे, किती साधू संतांनी येऊन इथे आपली मेहनत केलेली आहे ह्या तपोभूमीमध्ये, त्याचा विचार करा. आणि तुम्ही इथे जन्म कशाला घेतला मग असाही विचार करा की आमचा ह्या नाशकाला जन्म झाला एवढ्या पवित्र भूमीत आम्ही काय करायचं. नसत्या गोष्टींकडे लक्ष नसलं पाहिजे, नको ते पाहिजे ह्या प्रवृत्त्या सोडून जे हवं तिकडे लक्ष दिलं. समाधानात राहून आम्ही आता परमेश्वराच्या कार्याला लागलो आहेत. हे आयुष्य आमचं परमेश्वरासाठी आहे. हा जो काही आमच्या प्राणाचा दिवा लावलेला आहे तो परमेश्वराच्याच प्रकाशाला पसरवील अशा उमेदीने तुम्ही जर आला तर आनंदाच्या सागरात पोहाल. सगळं काही तुमचं बघण्यात येईल. परमेश्वर संबंध क्षेम देईल त्याच्यावर अत्यंत समाधानात आणि पूर्ण काय झालं संपूर्ण आपण आटपून घेतला आता पूर्ण झाला असं तुम्हाला वाटेल. परमेश्वर तुम्हा सर्वांना सुबुद्धी द्यावी.